Soren Kierkegaard is one of the most well-regarded philosophers of all time. Born May 5th of 1813 of Copenhagen, Denmark, he doctored in some of the most significant logical constructs of our day and age. His work has completely molded how we think and how we view fact, fiction, and subjective and objective truths. Because of this, he is considered the father of existentialism. Existentialism is a philosophical theory or approach which emphasizes the existence of the individual person as a free and responsible agent, determining their own development through acts of the will. To put that in more layman terms, it essentially means free will, that you control your outcomes, that you control yourself. In order to fully understand existentialism, it's probably smart to understand what would be existentialist. One prime example would be donating half of your income. To simply say, screw it, I don't need half my income. It's not all that important to me, but it could be incredibly important to other people that I could make a big difference in doing this. Shaving away social norms and following what you think is right is one of the most existential things you could do. Ultimately, being an individual, being an agent of will, is existentialism. It's incredibly difficult to put into words how drastically different of an outlook this was. That you did not have some preordained essence to you. That your central identity was not prescribed at birth. These ideas are so central to our lives that we can't even comprehend that they never existed. That if your father was a shoemaker, well, you're going to be a shoemaker too, and you'll carry on the family business. When someone tells you just to be yourself, to be wholly authentic, they are asking you to commit fully existential acts. This advice is very common today, but back then, not so much. As revolutionary as this way of thinking may be, I think Soren Kierkegaard has given us a way greater philosophical gift. One that gives one of the most compelling platforms for mental freedom, for understanding ourselves and how we operate within the world and with other people. And with this is some of his most underrated work. Because in tandem with his work on existentialism, he was extremely interested in the concept of the individual, of who you are. In trying to figure this out, he came to a very stark conclusion, that most people aren't necessarily people or individuals. They're just clones of other people. Because to ultimately open up that form of vulnerability, you open yourself up to criticism. You open yourself up to potential isolation. To Kierkegaard, this elicits the two greatest forms of anxiety that you can feel. The anxiety of feeling alone, and the anxiety of dealing with the infinite. Kierkegaard's insights on the infinite, the very human experience of having almost infinite options at your disposal, is where his work seems to be the most undervalued. Because as human beings, we have almost limitless options at our disposal. We could theoretically do anything we wanted, so long as it abides by the laws of physics. Ultimately, it feels like the world really is in our hands. And having that kind of power, that kind of control, over my life? In a world where we rely on authority, where the structure of everything relies on laws, rules, why do I have to control my life? I can barely motivate myself to do my homework. On something as important as the outcome of my life? This is too great of a task to ask of me. Even the most self-sufficient, the most independent people, of whom, if you took their freedom away, would be incredibly outraged, they too have also experienced this. And what is a very common response to this issue? It's to simply sit and do nothing at all. To completely enter the realm of procrastination. And who can honestly blame them? The world is incredibly cruel. There is judgment at every corner. We are often completely beat down and completely berated for other people's benefit. This is so ingrained into the human condition, almost all of us know at least one person who is stuck in limbo. And there's a great possibility that you are too. Have you ever met that guy fresh out of high school? He had a plan to go to art school. He had a plan to go to engineering school. But right out of high school, he just increases his hours at his part-time job. And what we see happen there is those dreams get kind of pushed to the wayside. He works the menial job that he absolutely hates, still lives with his parents, and then a couple years later, he moves out, lives with some roommates. The material side of his life slowly progresses as well. He might have a girlfriend, he might end up getting married, and he may end up having a child. But what happens is, he notices something. He notices that he is still completely discontent. That eventually, his life has sort of withered away. That he did not pursue his dreams. He did not pursue his interests. Maybe not because of material reasons per se, but because he was scared to fail. He was scared of what other people may have thought. And ultimately, he was scared of contending with the infinite. That when it came time for him to graduate high school, the easiest thing for him to do was just to pick up more hours at that menial job, ultimately sidelining his goals to quell his existential angst. That unbeknownst to him, this angst was far too much to fathom. It was far too much to contend with. And in the middle of this contention, he realized that his life slowly slipped away. We've met these people. We may have also been completely among them. They may be your family member. They may be the person in your family who is continually asked from uncles, aunts, grandparents about whether they've decided what they want to major in school or what new steps they have taken in pursuing their dreams. But Kierkegaard quickly understood that this is a very human condition. And not only was this a human condition, this may have also been a positive one as well. Not that you sat in the realm of procrastination for 30 years, but ultimately, because of this anxiety, because of this existential angst, you ultimately understood the power that you had in your hands, that you realized your capabilities. And because of this anxiety, because of this dilemma, there is a split. There is a direct dichotomy on how you approach this. We can enter the realm of procrastination. We can live in a metaphysical vegetative state. Or in choosing to recognize our freedom, we can completely move forward. We can become far more moral and capable human beings. That my actions, or more importantly, my inaction, has meaning. It has consequences. That there is power to be held in the realm of the infinite, and that ultimately I can decide how it is used. That if I also understand that I could enter the realm of procrastination, I could wither away in life, ultimately, I become closer to the true prescription. The prescription of simply putting your foot forward, of simply doing the absolute best that you can in life, of understanding that this is a game, and within that game, hopefully doing as much good as you possibly can, hopefully pursuing the things that interest you as much as you can. Because living in a world with limitless possibilities, of living with the infinite, can be quite fearful. It can also be much more beautiful and much more endearing. Thank you.